हेलो जेनिका, हाउ आर यू? Okay, let's get started. Okay, at first I want to thank you all for joining this live session. Right now we are on unit 3 dynamics, and then we have almost finished this unit 3 dynamics. So today our goal is to complete unit 3 post-test review. That is our goal. So we'll go through unit 3 post-test review. So before starting some of the questions from the post test, let me briefly go through what we did in our unit 3 dynamics. In our unit 3 dynamics, we talked about Newton's first law, second law, and third law of motion. And then also we talked about Newton's law of gravitation. And at the end of the unit, we talked about forces acting in two dimension. Okay, forces acting in two dimension. And for today's lesson, you will need some of the formulas that we have to use whenever we go through the post-test review. I'll write those formula as well. So if you remember Newton's second law of motion from there, net force acting on any system or object is equal to mass times acceleration. Net force is equal to mass times acceleration. That is the first one. And then second one is force due to friction. Okay. Right, F is your force due to friction is your coefficient of frictional force times normal force. And then normal force is always equal to mass times gravity. Third, force of attraction between any of the two objects is equal to force of attraction, or also gravitational force is equal to g times mass of the first object, mass of the second object over distance square. And then let me do the fourth one. And then weight of any object, or that is also force of gravity or weight. Just the right weight of any object is equal to mass of gravity, mass times gravity. So these are some of the formulas we might need to use whenever we go through this post-test review. Now, let me change the color of this pen as well. Sorry. Is that one okay? Okay, let's start with this question, okay? Here is my, I just want to make sure that you all are seeing this screen, okay? If you all are seeing this screen and listening to me, please give me a thumbs up. I just wanted to make sure. Okay, thank you very much. And then we'll work on around 10, 11 problems that are most significant problems from the post-test, okay? Let's start with this one. An object is acted upon by a force of 22 newtons to the right. So we applied certain force to 22 newtons to the right, and a force of 13 newtons to the left. This is right and another one is left. What is the magnitude and direction of the net force? Okay. So read this problem and try to answer this problem at first, and then I'll answer this question. So let me launch Paul. So you can answer this question through the poll. Okay, and if you did not see a poll, answer this question through the chat. Okay. And then I'll solve this problem. And make sure to take direction into account as well, okay? Let me in polling and answer this question. Thank you very much for the participation. So we do have 22 newtons to the right, 13 newtons to the left. So subtract 13 newtons from 22 newtons because your 22 newtons is bigger, think like that. So net force is 22 minus 13 newtons. That is equal to 9 newtons. Since 22 newtons is greater than 13 newtons, so the net force will act to the right. So the correct choice is A, 9 newtons to the right. And these are all the questions from your post test, okay? Once you understand all of these problems, you should be able to complete post test. Let me read this question and then I'll give you some time to answer this question. An object at rest requires a force of 15 newtons to set into motion. The force is greater than which force? So that means object is at rest and then we apply certain force, that is 15 newtons, to set into motion. Then that 15 newton is greater than which of those force? Tension, gravity, friction, electromagnetic, or a strong nuclear force. Let me launch poll again. Try to answer this question and then I'll answer it again. So what do you think? What would be the correct choice? I encourage all of you to take participation and answer this question, okay? Okay, let me cross that window and then I'll answer this question. So the correct choice for this question is C, friction. C, friction. So whenever object is in rest, and then if we apply certain force, that force should be always greater than to the frictional force, so that only the object start to move. Correct choice is C, friction. The question is, which statement is true for the object in dynamic equilibrium? Okay. Let me describe the term dynamic equilibrium. Whenever the object is in equilibrium condition in general, dynamic as well as static equilibrium, net force acting on that system is always equal to zero. Net force acting on that object or system is always equal to zero. And you know that net force is equal to mass times acceleration. And then now Based on those understanding, net force is equal to mass times acceleration, and that should be equal to zero. Try to answer this question. And then you do have five different choices here. Let me launch poll again. I'll give you around 1 minute to answer this question, and then I'll answer this question. Please make sure to go through all those choices, A, B, C, D, and E. Okay, I'm getting some of the answer. Okay, let me cross that window. Okay. So in this problem, net force is equal to zero. And then we know that net force is equal to mass times acceleration. Let me write it. Mass times acceleration is zero. So mass cannot be equal to zero. That is the constant quantity. So acceleration should be equal to zero. So that means object have zero acceleration. Correct choice is A, objects have zero acceleration. Let me go to the next question. The question is, what kind of motion indicates a system where the net force equals to zero? And then net force is equal to zero. And then you do have five different choices, accelerating objects, only accelerating stationary object, both accelerating and stationary objects, only objects moving with the constant positive velocity, and last one is stationary objects as well as objects moving with constant velocity. So think about those five different choices and try to answer this question. That's great. I already got one correct answer. Okay, thank you. Let me cross that window. The correct choice for this problem is E, that is stationary objects as well as objects moving with constant velocity. So we can see here net force is equal to zero. Net force is equal to zero. So accelerating object will not have net force equal to zero. Only stationary object? No. The objects that move with constant velocity will also have net force equal to zero. Both accelerating and stationary object? No. Accelerating object will not have net force equal to zero. D. Only objects moving with constant positive velocity? No. It will have net force equal to zero, but not only. That part, this choice is also wrong. So the correct choice is stationary object as well as object moving with constant velocity. Let's go to the next problem. Let me read that problem and then I'll give you some time to answer this question. If a ball is given an acceleration of 3 m/s² while being pushed with a force of 0.75 newtons, what is the mass? So here to solve this problem, we'll use Newton's second law of motion. That is net force is equal to mass times acceleration. Let us suppose F is net force is equal to mass times acceleration. Acceleration is 3 m/s². Net force is equal to 0.75 newtons. Use those two information, acceleration and net force, and calculate the mass of that object. So mass of that ball, sorry. I have launched the ball again. Calculate the mass of that object. Ball, sorry. Okay, thank you for your participation. Now let me work through this problem. So force is 0.75 newtons. Mass we have to calculate, acceleration is 3.0 m/s². Divide by 3 on both sides. 3 on both sides, 0.7 over 3 is 0.25. And mass is measured in kilograms. Kilograms, that is the mass of the ball. So the correct choice is B, 0.25 kilograms. We use Newton's second law of motion. Net force is equal to mass times acceleration. We plug in the value of force as well as acceleration, and from there we have calculated mass of that object, mass of the ball. Let's go to the next slide. This problem I'll work by myself, okay? Let me read this problem and then I'll complete this problem. Mary pushes a crate by applying a force of 18 newtons. Unable to push it alone, she gets help from her friend Annie. Together, they apply a force of 43 newtons. So that is the net force. And the crate just starts moving. That means that net force is also equal to force due to friction. F of S is force due to friction. If the coefficient of static friction, that is mu S, the coefficient of static friction is written as mu S 0.11. What is the value of normal force? So we have to calculate normal force. So force, static frictional force, F of S is equal to coefficient of static friction times normal force. This is frictional force. I'll just write frictional force, okay, frictional force. Static is static frictional force. Mu of S is your coefficient of static friction. And F of N is normal force, normal force. Now we'll substitute the value of frictional force and then coefficient of static friction and calculate the value of normal force. So frictional force is 43 newtons. And static coefficient of static friction is 0.11. We have to calculate normal force. So divide both sides by 0.11. 43 divided by 0.11 is Let me check that value in my note. Around 390 newton. 90 newtons. That is the normal force. And in scientific notation, it can be written as 3.9 times 10 to the power 2, 2 newtons. So we have to move that 0, 1, 2, 2 decimal places, newtons. The correct choice is C, that is 3.9 times 10 to the power 2 newtons, 10 to the power square newtons. So if you have question about this problem, please let me know, okay? I know this question is a little bit difficult compared to other problems. And then if you understood this problem, please give me a thumbs up or any other reaction. Now let's go to the next question. So the question is, Ted wants to hang a wall clock on the wall by using a string. If the mass of the wall clock is 0.250 kilograms, what should be the tension of the string so that it can sustain the weight of the wall clock? That means tension of the string should be exactly equal to the weight of the wall clock so that it can sustain the weight of the wall clock. Make that diagram. So let us suppose this is the clock. Okay, this is the clock. And then tension on the string acts vertically upward through the string P, and then weight of the wall clock acts vertically downward. W is your mass times gravity. Now in this case, we have to find the tension of the string so that it can sustain the weight of the wall clock. That means tension of the string should be exactly equal to the weight of the clock. That is T is equal to mass times acceleration of gravity. And mass is given 0.250. Acceleration of gravity is 9.8. So if we multiply that together, we got 2.545 newtons. Correct choice is B, 2.45 newtons. So here tension and then weight of the clock are equal to each other so that there is no any net force acting in the vertical direction. And then weight of the clock is mass times acceleration of gravity, and that is equal to tension. In that way, we can calculate tension on the string. Okay. Now, please let me know if you have any question on this problem. I'll pause here for some time. Let's go to the next question. The question is, an object is in static equilibrium, and has a coefficient of friction is 0.110. If the normal force acting on the object is 95 newtons, what is the mass of the object? So normal force is always equal to mass times gravity. Gravity, if the object is in static equilibrium, okay? So object is not moving like that. Here we do have weight of the object that acts vertically downward, and then normal force acts perpendicular to the surface of the object. Okay. And then normal G is your acceleration of gravity is 9.8 meter per second square. Normal force is 95 newtons. Use those information and try to calculate mass of that object. I'll give you some time. use normal force, acceleration of gravity, and calculate mass of that object. Let me cross that window. Here, normal force is equal to 95 newtons. So that is 95.0. To calculate mass of that object, acceleration of gravity is 9.8. Divide both sides by 9.8. And then mass is equal to 95 divided over 9.8 is equal to around 9.70 kilograms. So the correct choice is A, 9.70 kilograms. If you have understood this problem, please give me a thumbs up, okay? All of you, please give me a thumbs up or any other reaction if you understood this problem. Okay, thank you very much. Now let me read this problem and then I'll give you some time to work on this problem. Object A attracts object B with a gravitational force of 5 newtons from a given distance. So let us suppose we have object A with mass MA is mass of object A, MB is mass of object B, and let us suppose distance is R and force of gravity is your 5 newtons. If the distance between the two objects is reduced to half, so half means now distance is R over 2, what will be the changed force of attraction between them? So we have to calculate change force of attraction between them, that is Fg dash, and Ma and Mb are same. So force of attraction between the two objects is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. Okay, inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. So let me write that formula. Force of attraction is G, universal gravitational constant, product of the mass divided by R square. Okay. Use that formula and also use the help of those two figures and try to calculate the changed force of attraction between them. I'll give you some time. I have already launched the poll. Please make sure to respond. And do it slowly, okay? Take your time. I'll give you some time to work on this problem. Okay, now let me work through this problem. So F of G in first case is 5 newtons. So let me write that value and leave everything as it is, B over R square. Now in second case, write same formula, G m a times m b mass over, now this times distance is r over 2 square. Let's simplify this. G times m a m b over, it becomes r square over 4. So r square over 4. Now we know that if we are dividing by fraction, that 4 goes to the top and we have to multiply. G m a m b over r square times 4. And that value is equal to 5, so it becomes 5 times 4 is 20 newtons. 20 newton. So the correct choice is D, 20 newtons. Also, you can think another way. Force of gravity is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. So inversely proportional to square of the distance. In the distance is reduced to half, means 1 over 2 square, 1 over 4, but inversely proportional to means it becomes force times the initial value of the gravitational force. So that becomes 4 times 5 is your 20 newtons. Now let's go to the next question. The question is, a 70 kilogram mountaineer is standing on the summit of Mount Everest. Make the diagram, okay? Let us suppose we do have Mount Everest here, okay? Summit of the Mount Everest, and this is a mountaineer. Distance is R. The distance between the mountaineer and the center of the earth, this is the center of the earth, is 6.39 times 10 to the power 6 meters. What is the magnitude of force of gravity acting on the mountaineer? So magnitude of the force of gravity on the mountaineer is, we'll use the formula for the gravitational force, that is G mass of the man, is that I'll just write mountaineer, okay, mass of the mountaineer, mm means mass of the mountaineer, mass of the earth over r square. Okay. R is the distance between the center of the earth and the mountaineer. After that, let's substitute all those values and calculate force of gravity acting on the mountaineer. G is, the value of G is 6.673 times 10 to the power negative 11. Mass of the man is 70 kilogram. Mass of earth is 5.98. 10 to the power 24. Over R square is 6.39. Times 10 to the power 6 square. Okay. So we used formula at first, and then formula for the force of attraction between two objects. And then after that, we substitute all the values of G, mass of man, mass of mountaineer, and mass of earth, and then distance between mountaineer and the center of the earth. After that, you can use calculator and calculate that value. This value is approximately 684 newtons. So the correct choice is C. So that is the magnitude of force of gravity acting on the mountaineer, 684 newtons. I'll give you sometimes, make sure you understand this problem, okay? Please let me know if you have any question on this problem, and if you understood this problem, Please give me a thumbs up or any other reaction. Okay, thank you. Now let's go to another question then. The question is, a force of 100 Newton is applied to a box at an angle of 36 degree with horizontal. We do have a force, that force is 100 Newton applied to a box at an angle of 36 degree like that. If the mass of the box is given 25 kilograms, what is the horizontal acceleration of the box? This question is a little bit tricky. So we do have a force, but the question is asking what is the horizontal acceleration of the box. So at pause, let's calculate the acceleration that acts an angle of 36 degree to the horizontal. So we know that force is equal to 100 Newton, and force is also equal to mass times acceleration. And mass is equal to 25, so 25 times A is your 100. Divide both sides by 25. So acceleration is equal to 4 meter per second square. After that, we have to calculate horizontal acceleration of the box. So that means we have to calculate horizontal component of acceleration. Write it here. Horizontal acceleration is equal to, so if we are calculating horizontal component, we have to multiply in our case acceleration by cosine of that angle 36 degree. That means A times cosine of 36 degree, A is your acceleration, that is 4 cosine 36 degree. And you can use Desmos to calculate that value or any other scientific calculator. And that would be around, let me see my answer, 3.24 meter per second square. 24 meters per second square. So the correct choice is B, that is 3.24 meters per second square. So we have completed at least 10 problems from the post test. So now you should be able to complete your post test from unit 3. Okay, post test from unit 3. And also I'll suggest all of you to work hard and maintain your pace. Okay, maintain your pace. If you have any question, please stay here with me. If you do not have any question, you can leave this live session. Keep working on your courseware. Bye bye. Have a great day.